Transfiguration Sunday, a fourth day in the life of Christ, foreshadows things to come. How do we figure into the transfiguration? Have you ever watched a child learning to walk? Have you watched a child approach stairs and stop? Did you rush over to stop him from falling down, or did you watch to see what he or she tried to do? A few years ago, when Kyle was only 2 and a half years old, I watched him one day. I was sitting on the front porch of the swing. He was about 4 or 5 feet away. He approached the steps off the porch. I stopped. Now, I could have rushed over, grabbed him, and said, "No, no, no, don't go there. You're going to fall, you're going to get hurt." Instead, I sat there and watched. And he walked up the steps, and he looked, and looked down, and he looked up, and reached his hand up, and grabbed the rail, and stepped down. And stepped down, 4 steps down to the floor. I knew then that he was a problem solver. I knew he could figure out why. So I wasn't close enough to stop him from getting hurt, but I was close enough to pick him up and say, "Okay, you're all right." So you think about that. God, today, Transfiguration Sunday, Jesus walks up into the mountain. And he's there, and a cloud comes down, and the three disciples with him see him with Moses and Elijah. A cloud comes on, and we hear this voice out of the cloud: "This is my son, with whom I'm well pleased. This is my son, pay attention to him." His face changes, his clothes become so bright, they're hard to look at. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we have gathered together today in praise and worship in your presence to hear your word to come to life as your son. We wonder at his transfiguration and give thanks to his life. We ask for the gift of the Holy Spirit that we also might be changed, transformed, free to sin, and empowered to spread the good news of the gospel, that through baptism, through the celebration and partaking of the Eucharist, that we be renewed in spirit and share our faith, that others would seek to know the truth and seek salvation to your Son, our Lord and Savior, in whose precious name we pray. Amen. Now you think about the journey that Christ is on. This period of time, he has attended temple, taught, he's performed miracles, he preached the new gospel of salvation, and now he still must be transformed. As we celebrate the transfiguration of Christ, let's look back at the previous verses of Luke 9. In that, we have the miracle of the feeding of the 5,000. He takes 5 loaves of bread, 2 fishes, and feeds 5,000 people. Not only does he feed the 5,000, he has 12 baskets of food left over. Would that be sufficient? It goes on. He goes to his disciples. He feeds the crowd. Now he's in praying in private sometime later. He says, "Who did the crowd say that I am?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others that one of the prophets. But he says, "What about you?" He asks, "Who do you say that I am?" And Peter answers, "God's Messiah." Shouldn't that be sufficient? Shouldn't that be enough right there that he's performed the miracles, he spread the word, that people believe in him, that he doesn't need to do any more? Instead, this day he comes in, and he's in this cloud, and they see him with Moses and Elijah. And he comes out, and his face is changed. His clothes are so bright, you can't stand to look at them. I want you to think about this. They are in a desert environment. They travel, they walk, their feet are dirty, their clothes are dirty. You want to be the person that's going to clean his clothes? I think several years ago there was a commercial about whiteness, how clothes are white, how bright white your clothes could be, how bright your clothes could be. Think about this. The females were following, look upon him, and they're going to wash his clothes, and they said, "Can you believe how bright and white his clothes are? Look at his face, it's changed. Why does he have to go through this transfiguration? Why do we have to hear from God himself, that these disciples hear? God said, 'This is my son, listen to me.' After all, should miracles have done it? Should the feeding of the crowd, the 5,000, have done it? Should his word, the message that he gives, shouldn't that be sufficient? I want you to think about this. Because Wednesday, again, Ash Wednesday comes along, we're going to be on the 6-week journey with Christ, the final days, and there's going to be fruit of change in his life. As you think about a child and his journey through life, we experience many changes, many transformations. A child's born, a child's baptized, christened, takes his first step, says his first word, gets his first tooth, first day of school. All those changes a child makes through the journey of life. When we baptize a child, we say, marked by the sign of the cross forever. Transformation. Again, 6 weeks from today is Confirmation Sunday. We take all these young people, the last 2 years, who've been going to catechism, and we're going to bring them forward in front of the congregation, and we're going to confirm them as members of the body of Christ. With that confirmation, with that change, comes responsibilities. Now they're adults. They participate in the sacraments. They get to take, eat of the body of Christ. They get to drink of the blood of Christ. They become voting members of this congregation. Responsibility. We're going to give them each offering envelopes. They get to participate in the financial well-being of this church, of reaching out to others. Change, transformation. Christ is transfigured on this day. This is the day we celebrate that. This is the day we look forward to his change. We look forward to that journey he takes. You think about it. 6 weeks from today is Palm Sunday, Confirmation Sunday, this time. His triumphant entry into Jerusalem that day on the ass. Palm fronds, everybody's, hey, great, we got a Savior. By the end of the week, he's under trial. He's been betrayed. His own favorite disciple denies him 3 times. He's a common criminal. He's put to death. And think about that scene of the death. His punishment, how they treat him. He's on the cross to grief with common criminals. That's the lowest form of death in Roman society. We've taken our hero at the beginning of the week, and now we don't want anything to do with him. Even his own father, because the night before he's taken into custody, he goes to the Garden of Gethsemane, and he's in the dark, and he's praying to God, if thy will be done, take this cup away from me. His first prayer. He goes back, the disciples are sound asleep. Wakes him up. Pay attention. Watch over me. Goes back in. Prayers again. If I have to drink of the blood of this cup, I mean of death, if I have to take on death, I will. Goes back, wakes the disciples up again. Goes back a 3rd time in prayer. He asks again for God to save him from what he knows is his destiny. We've taken this hero, and in our culture, we do that with our heroes. We build them up. They're great. They can do no wrong until we find out about their past. We find out the speeding tickets, about the indiscretion, about the marital infidelities, and we tear them apart, tear them down. We don't want anything to do with them. So how can Christ take this journey knowing on this day that his face is altered, that his appearance is so bright that the disciples have trouble looking at him? They see Moses, they see Elijah. Thus we forget that Moses himself, going up on the mountain to get the 10 commandments come down, he's transfigured, he's changed too. His face is shining so brightly that this is his own group of people have trouble looking at him. Elijah, a prophet who looks forward to Christ more than any other prophet. Moses and Elijah are there with them in the crowd, in that cloud. They point to Christ as the Son of God. What do we do with the Son of God? What are we doing these next 6 Sundays? That he is in prayer, and apparently his own father doesn't talk back to him. He doesn't respond to Christ's prayer. On the cross, please forgive them, they know not what they do. The pain he goes through, and where is God in all this? And God is the truth. He's so holy that he cannot abide sin. It cannot be in his presence. When we think about the temple process, when the high priests have their own entrance into the temple, they can't be contaminated get to go into the most holy place to do atonement for the nation of Israel. They cannot have any appearance, no contamination of all sin at all. And Christ takes that all upon himself. How do we respond to that? How do we respond to this transfiguration? How do we, in our lives, in our changes, our transformation ourselves, in our journey to Christ, what happens to us? How do we transform ourselves to be more Christ-like? It isn't a single day, a single event that says, oh, right now we're Christians, we're forever saved, forever cleansed of sins. It's a constant journey. Just as Kyle reached up, grabbed that handrail, and safely beat him down, we also need to understand, we raise ourselves in prayer to God, our hands to God, forever needing his guidance, his blessings, his understanding, his patience, the gift of the Holy Spirit. Years ago, I read a story about an Indian faker, and he's the F-A-K-I-R. And what these guys would do, when they go in penance and they'd be begging for alms, and one guy did this and left his hand up there, his arm at that place. Now, you get tired after a couple minutes, but that's holy nothing. This guy did that long enough. He went through all the pain and the agony, holding his arm in place, that his arm, his joints ossified. He couldn't move his arm better than like that. That's the image we have of raising ourselves in prayer and supplication to Christ, to God, of asking for forgiveness, transforming ourselves from our old sinful selves, the death of our physical self, to the reborn in the Spirit. Where are we on that journey? Again, we're going to have the confirmants come up 6 weeks, bring them into the church, and where do they go from there? Do we encourage them to still continue to attend? Because now, again, we're treating them as adults in this congregation. They have responsibilities, not just rights, but responsibilities. Where are we? Are there encouraging them on that path, on that journey through life? Do we encourage each other? Do we confess our faith publicly? Or is it a light under a bushel? Transfiguration. Christ went through transfiguration for us. Where do we go on that transformation? Not one big event. Small steps we take, like a child. Small events, 12 to 13. 13 to 16. Is that day so important that we forever change our life? Is that day that we're baptized, that we're confirmed, forever change our life? Where are we on that journey? Now, we're not going to be transfigured like Christ, but we are transformed from our old selves to our new selves. Our old selves are dead to us. Paul makes this great statement in the book of Romans that says, I do, but I don't want to do. I don't do what I want to do. Complicated, simple, he says, I do what I don't want to do. He's acknowledging then him as a self, as a follower of Christ. He wants to get away from sin. He wants to forget that. He wants to give away his old earthly self. I don't do what I want to do. He wants to be Christ-like. He wants to follow Christ. He exemplifies the life of Christ for everybody who sees him. Jesus figured his face is changed. Now, it doesn't say how it's changed, but it's changed. His clothes become so bright. One translation says it's like being struck by lightning. So white, so beautiful white, that we can't stand to look upon it. In our walks, in our walk of faith, are we transformed like that? That people look at us and know, just by looking at us, that we are followers of Christ. Does our face reflect that glory? It's easy here in a church setting, Sunday morning, to say, okay, we're praising and worshiping Christ. It feels good to be here. It feels good to sing all the songs, to hear the praise, be part of that liturgy. But when we walk out into the world, do we keep that with us? Does that transformation change stay with us? Because we know the 13-year-old is going to become a 14-year-old. 14 is going to become 16, driving a car, become a voter, serve the armed forces. All those steps and changes we take, do they reflect the baptism, the confirmation in our lives? How do we reflect that? Do we give away all the clothes we had in the closet the day before we were baptized? Do we just were pure light. How do we reflect that transformation? How do we reflect the importance of Christ in our life? How do we understand and accept that Christ died for our sins? We're washed clean. Today we're taking communion. We fully understand what that is, the body of Christ, the blood of Christ, shed for our sins. In our walk, in our faith walk, do we continually reach up to God, continually reach up to Christ and ask for his help? Or do we say we can do it on our own? Do we belittle the political candidate that says 2 Corinthians instead of 2 Corinthians? If somebody looks at the Bible, who's never read the Bible before, and sees those two, who might say we belittle over that. Or do we step forward and raise them up in faith? Do we help each other? Are we on that path to Christ? Do we understand fully what he did for us?